to be with you. nothing without you. Oh, we live and move, we have our being. Live without you, we live without you. You are live and move and have. Hosanna, Hosanna. Without you.
everything that we think we are is because of you. It is by your grace that we stand. I pray over your people right now that there will be a remembrance of your goodness, a reminder of your faithfulness, that every trial, every mountain, every valley that you've carried us through, Father, has been by your grace. The very ground that we stand on now, Father, is by your grace. And Father, this morning we come, we've met surrender this morning, Father. I pray that we will continue to surrender and give you every crown, every victory, every good and perfect gift that you've given us, Father. We give it back to you right now in the name of Jesus. Because we love you, Father, and we are nothing without you. In times like these, Father, we need you more than ever. In you we live and move and have our being.
prophesy.
Jesus,
and open eyes. Open eyes. tongue confess Jesus is the Lord. Every knee, every tongue, and every knee will bow, every tongue confess. We believe it, that every knee will bow, every tongue confess. We believe it. We believe it now. That every knee will bow, and every tongue confess. We believe it. Standing on, and he's more real than wind in your lungs. Jesus is Lord. Jesus is Lord. You're more real. He is more than able. We find our hope in you. We find our trust in you. You are able, more than able. Jesus is Lord.
in this place, oh God. No other name like Jesus. No other name. No one beside. No one above. This morning it's all about you, oh Jesus. We give you the glory, we give you the honor for the tenderness of worship in this place. Every time we step in, Father, every time we press in, you amaze us. We pray now that you will speak and bless your word. Continue to flow with us, Father. Allow us to flow with you. Allow us to flow with your spirit this morning. Where the river flows, we will follow. And we are excited this morning to hear what you have for us. In Jesus' name, amen, amen. Good morning. You just kill a flippy. Kill a few guys here. Amen. 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 Hallelujah. Are you guys all well? Good to see you all. Thank you, Lalita, Zantel. If I'm on those playlists, when? Our playlist that has no order at the moment. Isn't that amazing? Isn't it? You don't want to know, man. The team, you don't want to know. I think we go through anxiety every time we come here. Because we have this plan. We just want to sing those three songs, please. And every time we get you. Well, we need to learn the lesson. Somewhere along the line, we need to say, well, we don't know anymore. It's a nightmare for the words person, because like, we have no clue where we're going. But oh, thank you, Father, that we can be pliable, and thank you that we can be obedient to your Holy Spirit. I'd rather be obedient than right, isn't it? I'd rather be obedient than bring my sacrifice of three songs. Holy Spirit, thank you. Oh, we had a beautiful weekend, haven't we? In the Lord, we were Vicky yesterday. For those of you guys who don't know, Vicky is moving by the Spirit, we believe, and empowered to do what God has called her to do. And this morning I pray that the Lord will take us and empower us. Can you say empower? And the Lord will empower us to do what we are meant to do what he set us out to do, that we no longer will be moving in our own strength. Burn that in your spirit, not moving in our own strength, but that we will move by his spirit. So if you turn with me to Philippians 4 verse 13, you know the scripture. It says, I can do all things. You can complete it for me. I can do all things through Christ that strengthens me. Another version would say, through Christ who gives me strength. He gives me strength. He strengthens me. I can do all things because of that. You see, it starts off with the I. And if we can talk a lot about the I. And if we continue in the I vein, me, myself, and I. And I hope that tense is all correct. Madam teacher. If we continue in that vein, we can't achieve much in our own strength. In fact, you will do some things and you will find that you will burn out along the way. But when you take on the strength of Christ, when you take on the position of being a son and a daughter of Christ, it means you surrender. It means the I becomes smaller. John said, John the Baptist, when he heard about Jesus, he said, my joy is complete, for he must increase and I must decrease. That was a powerful in the right order. Amen. Amen. He must increase and I must decrease. Amen. And that is so important for us daily. Daily. Daily when the eye stands up out of bed in the morning, say, you need to decrease this morning. Before you continue on your day, say, I need to become less and I need to find out, God, what do you want from me? Which way will you take me this morning? You see, when you take on that positioning of Father, Jesus first, me second, you will be amazed at where God leads you. You will be amazed at, we sang this morning, open hearts, open eyes. You'll be amazed at what you see when you move by His Spirit. The same room of people will be transformed to you when you are moving by His Spirit. He will give you eyes and visions. He will give you that laser vision. Our son is into superheroes. So He gives you vision to see right through flesh and bone, to heart and spirit. And he can give you words of knowledge, words of wisdom. I need to pray for you. The Lord showing me that I need to pray for you for your work situation. That's when you're moving by the Spirit. Amen. This is the key for us. Every day, let us say, it is he who gives me strength, not myself. Amen. So this morning, we were on Matthew 16:16. We spoke a while back about this piece of passage in the Scriptures. Matthew 16, the confession of faith. This is powerful, and I believe the Lord is taking us on a journey. You know, we had this statement a while ago that says, I believe, I still believe. And the Lord is taking us to be a people who understands that statement, I still believe. I still believe because of who he is. Amen. So, verse 15 says, what about you? Jesus asked them, who do you say that I am? And Simon Peter, we're going to talk a little bit about Peter this morning. Reckless Peter. Reckless, wild, unpredictable Peter in the Bible. The word says it came to him, this man, to get the discovery. You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God. And Jesus said, blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah. This was not revealed to you by flesh, by man, by flesh or blood. They burned that in your spirit. The flesh, the eye did not reveal that to you. The spirit revealed to you who the Messiah is. Praise God for that. I can already finish my message right there. The flesh did not reveal it to you. His spirit revealed it to you. It was revealed to you by my Father in heaven. And I tell you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church. And the gates of hell will not overcome it. I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. Whatever you bind on earth, this is why we've got a war room behind us. Because whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven. Hallelujah. When you pray, when you step into that room and you start to pray, you need to know that you are standing in the gap. And everything you bind on earth will be bound on heaven. Everything you loose will be loosed. Amen. There's power in our prayer. Whatever will be bound in heaven and whatever is loosed on earth will be loosed in heaven. Thus he ordered the disciples not to tell anyone who he was. So go a little further with me. This is applicable to our story this morning. Verse 21. From that time on, Jesus began to explain to his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem to suffer many things at the hands of the elders, the chief priests and the teachers of the law, and that he must be killed, and on the third day he will be raised to life. But Peter, here's Peter again, Peter took him aside. Peter took Jesus aside. I want you to see this picture. It's hilarious, actually. Peter took the Messiah. The Lord just revealed to him that this is the Son of God. And Peter said, you said you're going to, let me speak to you. Let me tell you quickly. Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. The Son of the living God. I'm talking about flesh now. Never, my God, never, Lord, will this happen to you. But Jesus turned and said to him, get behind me, Satan. You are a stumbling block. The flesh is a stumbling block for you. You do not have in mind what concerns God, but you have human fleshly concerns. This must take place. Amen. It goes on there. Now you can turn with me to Romans 8 quickly before we continue in the story. I'm talking about the flesh and the spirit. Now I want you to understand this message. It speaks to me first about flesh. Sometimes we in our strength, there's business people in the room, and they can relate. Sometimes in business you see an obstacle, you know, you see a challenge before you. And what do? In our business minds, we think it through. We figure it out. We try and make a way where there seems to be no way. we say, Jesus, come here. Let me speak to you quickly. Let me pull you aside and say, Jesus, let me explain to you what must happen now. And Jesus says, get behind me. Get behind me. Let me lead you. Don't you lead me. Hallelujah. So I'm blessed this morning with this message. Romans 8 says this. We'll be all over the place in Romans 8. I love Romans 8. It's one of my favorite passages. So we're going to be all over the show in that passage. Verse 1. There is now no condemnation, praise God,
We spoke about this yesterday. There is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus, because through Christ Jesus, the law of the Spirit, who gives life, has set you free from the law of sin and death. Thank you, Jesus. Verse 5, those who live according to the flesh have their mind set on what the flesh desires, Peter. But those who live according to the Spirit have their mind set on what the Spirit desires. That's Jesus' will for our lives. The mind governed by flesh is death, but the mind governed by the Spirit is life and peace. Thank you, Lord. Verse 14, this is very important. For those who are led by the Spirit, they are called the children, the sons and daughters of God. When you are led by the Spirit, you move into that sonship. You move into that covering that He has so freely given you. The veil was torn that you can step into the sonship. Do you have something for us there, Adisu son? Do you have nothing there that you want to add? No, not at all. I'm just checking you out there. If you have something, you must bring it. For those who are led by the Spirit are the sons of God, the children of God. The Spirit you receive does not make you slaves, so that you live in fear, but rather the Spirit you have received has brought you to adoption to sonship. And by this we cry out, Abba Father. Verse 19. And this is the people, the generation that God is calling for. For creation waits in eager expectation for the sons and daughters, for the children of God to be revealed. Those who are completely led by the Spirit. So you ask yourself this morning, why am I here? You are here this morning to be a son and a daughter. You are here because creation awaits for you to be who you are called to be by His Spirit. For the times that we are in to be revealed. Amen. You ask yourself, I often ask myself, Father, why are we in this generation? We said a few weeks ago, we are at the height of sin. Why have you placed us as your people in this generation where sin is so rife in the world, where we're facing a virus that seems to have no end? Just when we think the one variant is finished, the next variant begins. And we ask ourselves, Father, in South Africa, the work is getting less and less. The crime is going up. And you ask yourself, Father, why are we here? We are here because creation is an eager expectation. We are here because creation is awaiting for us to say, I will take my place as a son and a daughter of the Most High God, led by His Spirit only. Not led by my flesh, not led by my ideas, led by my Spirit only. Amen? Okay, so we've got that. So the confession of Peter, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God, means I surrender as a son. Can we get that together? Confession equals surrender. Say it with me. Confession equals surrender. Amen. When I say you are the Christ, when you bring someone to the Lord in the confession that He is the Son of the living God, you bring yourself to submission that He is Lord and Savior. Amen. So now we are in Luke 22. This is where our story continues. We're talking about wild man Peter. So Peter represents us, doesn't it? Sometimes Peter represents us in our own flesh. Then the day came of unleavened bread. We're on verse 7. Luke 22, verse 7. Luke 22, verse 7. Which the Passover lamb had to be sacrificed, and Jesus sent Peter and John, saying, go and make preparations for the Passover. They asked him, where do you want us to prepare for it? And he replied, as you enter the city, a man carrying a jar of water will meet you. Follow him to his house. And say to the owner of the house, the teacher asks, where is the guest room? Where is the upper room? Where is the upper room? Where I may eat the Passover with my disciples. He will show you a large room upstairs, which is furnished, it is ready. Make preparations there. Verse 13. They left and found things just as Jesus has told them, so they prepared for the Passover meal. When the hour had come, Jesus and his apostles reclined at the table. And he said to them, I have eagerly desired to eat this meal with you. Creation eagerly awaits. I have eagerly desired to eat this meal with you. For I tell you, I will not again eat until the fulfillment of his kingdom. Verse 17. After taking the cup, he gave thanks and said, take this and divide it among you. For I tell you that I will not again drink of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God has come. Verse 19, and then he took the bread, gave thanks. This is the communion, isn't it, that we speak of. He took the bread, gave thanks, broke it, and said to them, this is my body given to you in remembrance of me. We take the communion. Why do we take the communion? In remembrance of who he is, of what he has done for us. There's power in his blood. There's power in his body. Every time we do the table, we are reminded of what he has done for us. That in him is our strength. I can do all things through him who strengthens me. When I drink of the cup, I realize of the blood that he shed for me, that there is still power in the blood. Amen. There is still power in the blood. When you pray the blood of the Lamb, there is power. There is protection. That's why every day before we leave our house, I say a short prayer before I leave, before my family wakes up in the morning. I said, the blood of the Lamb over them, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Let the protection of God be over them as I leave the house now. Because I know, then I go, I don't go to work in panic. Stress poppies. Stressing, I wonder if they're going to be okay. Will Eleanor drive the car safely to the... When I say the blood of the Lamb, I go to work in peace and filled with rest in knowing that my family is covered by more than what I could ever do. As the dad, the father of the house, he's covered by the blood. Get out the way. Say to somebody, get out the way. Get out of the way. Let the blood do the work in Jesus' name. The communion, the remembrance of what he has done for us. Verse 21, but the hand of him who is going to betray me is with mine on the table. The Son of Man will go as it has been decreed, but woe to the man that betrays me. Verse 23, and they began to question among themselves who would do this. I highlighted this in my Bible because this blows my mind every time. So Jesus just explains to them that I'm about to go to the cross. There's power in my blood. There's power in my body. And then human nature. Maybe that's why I have a lot of friends. I have a lot of people who like to be friends, but I choose not to have too many. A dispute arose among the mighty apostles that asked, who of us will be the greatest? Who will be the greatest? I tell you, if it's about who is the greatest, then we must pack our bags and leave. If we're at the throne room, if we're at this church that God has birthed sovereignly, if it starts becoming about who is the greatest, then we must close the doors, shut it up. Marty, sluit maar die deur. Ons kom weer terug nie. It is not about who is the greatest. Please. It is about his glory. It is about his will for us. It's about what God has called us as the church to be. Amen. Just because I'm standing here doesn't make me Mr. Wonderful either. Can I put that out there? Because I'm standing behind the pulpit doesn't make... Don't desire... Please. Don't desire to stand here. I'm telling you. Monday morning is waiting for you. Monday morning is waiting for you. You know, I would easily, you can ask those who have been with us for a long time, I would easily, and I don't want to speak about myself too much, but I want to show you the picture. I would much rather be sitting in that seat right now, bro. I would much rather be saying, amen, praise God, bless you, than standing here in front of God's people, because you will be weighed and you will be measured. You will face the fire. You will face the test. But when you don't desire it, when you don't want it, that is when you are in a position that God can use you. The minute you say, I don't want it, Father, I want your will to be done. I'm talking about true humility. True humility, that is when God can say, now I will lift you up. For it is him who, he humble, those who are humble of heart, he lifts them up at the appointed time. Amen. Amen. You're in the spirit room. Those of you guys who couldn't hear on the live stream, the Garden of Gethsemane, let the cup be taken from me, Father. But not my will, but your will be done. That is a picture of humility. Mm-hmm. Because through the pain, you would be glorified. You knew that. And yet he still asked, if you will take the cup, let it be taken from me. Where were we? They were arguing about who is the greatest. Say Jesus is the greatest. Jesus is the greatest. Amen. Let us continue. Verse 31, Jesus says to Simon again, Simon Peter, Simon, Simon, Satan has asked to sift you all as wheat. Satan has asked me to come and take every one of you in this room. But the word says, but I have prayed for you, Simon, that your faith may not fail you. Say with me, your faith will not fail. Your faith will not fail. Simon, that your faith may not fail you for the test that is about to come your way. You see, we face tests every day. Every day we face challenges, we face tests. But your faith will not fail you if you move by His Spirit. Your flesh will fail you every single time. But your faith will not fail you. And when you have turned back, Simon Peter, that you will strengthen your brothers. Isn't it? Isn't it? When you have turned back, Jesus knew something was coming here. Something is coming here. When you have turned back from your wicked ways, that you will come and strengthen your brothers. Because, you see, God is so gracious. This Peter, we've seen already, just a little piece that we're reading, he has been so in the flesh. He's been so in his own strength. And yet Jesus remembered the confession of faith and said, upon this rock I will still build my church. Upon this confession, Peter, there is still hope for you. Even though you are about to fail me, there is still grace enough for you to achieve what God has called you to achieve. And Peter stood up again. Verse 33, Lord, I am ready to go with you to prison and even to hang on the cross with you. And Jesus answered him, Peter, before the rooster crows today, you will deny me three times. You're welcome to interrupt. Amen. It's ordained. Amen. It wasn't a surprise though. Amen. Amen. He knew, you're so spot on there, is that Jesus knew that this must take place. The denial must take place. We'll get to that. Is my crunch line, actually. Thank you. Before the rooster crows today, you will deny me three times. Remember what Peter said, I will go with you all the way. Basically what he's saying, I will go all the way with you. Let's check what's going on next. Then Jesus went to pray on the Mount of Olives. That's what you're talking about. Verse 42 says, Father, if you're willing, take this cup from me, yet not my will, but yours be done. Amen. And then, verse 49, when Jesus' followers saw what was going on, they said to the Lord, this is where Judas is betraying him, and they came to take Jesus. When they saw what was going on, they asked Lord, this blows me also, they asked Lord, should we strike them with our swords? Beautiful. Lord, what do you think? Should we attack these guys? But Peter, you can read this in John. John chapter 18 tells you it was Peter. So while they were still inquiring of the Lord, Father, what do you think we should do with our swords? Peter had already decided. Nobody's coming near my master. And he started chopping them. I kind of like the spirit on the one. He's so real. He's so human. He was so ready to defend the master. And he struck his ear off. And Jesus said, no more of this. Touched him and healed his ear. Said, "Hou net op asseblief. Los my net." Verse 54. Then seizing Jesus, they led him away and took him to the house of the high priest. And this is a good moment for Peter. He's following. The others dispersed like sheep, but Peter and John, they are following now. They're following at a distance. And when some there had kindled a fire, can I say to you this? When some of them there had kindled a fire in the middle of the courtyard and had sat down, Peter sat with them. Be careful what fire you sit at. There are many fires in the earth at the moment. Not all of them are from God. Not all of them are meant for the season that you are in. If I sit at every fire and I partake of the conversation of every single fire, I can come back to the fire that God has called me for and I can have a complete confusion of spirit when I sit at too many fires. But when I sit at the fire that God has ordained for me, the word will be in season. The word will be meant for what is about to take place. He will give you instruction. He will give you direction. He will make sure that your foot will not stumble. So be careful what fires you sit at. There are many fires in the earth at the moment. Peter sat down with him, and a servant girl saw him and seated there by the firelight. She looked at him closely and said, "This man was with him." But Peter, he denied it. He said, "Woman, I don't know him." Denial number one. It was the same man who cut off the ear, who was so zealous. In this moment, I don't know him. Sitting at another fire. We can preach about that, eh? Sitting at another fire. A little later, someone else saw him and said, "You are also one of them." And Peter said, "Man, I am not." And about 1 hour later, another asserted, "Certainly, this fellow was with him, for he is a Galilean." And Peter replied, "Man, I don't know him." Some translation said he started swearing. He was so upset with him. "Man, I don't know what you are talking about." And just as he was speaking, the clock went off. The rooster crowed. As he was still uttering those words, the word of the Lord came to pass. The word of the Lord will not return void. Amen. The rooster crowed. And this is beautiful, verse 61. So as the rooster crowed, can someone give me a little crow there? Bram, I can see you doing a crow. Bram, just give me a little cock crow there. The rooster crowed in the distance. Thank you, Ram. That's part of my demonstration this morning. As the crowed, cockle doodle doo. At that moment, look, this is important. When the cock crowed and Peter was standing at the fire, this is so powerful. The Lord looked and turned towards him. And that's all that it says there, full stop. The Lord turned and looked straight at Peter. Let's read it again. The Lord turned and looked at Peter. Just looked at him. My God. And when he looked at him, Peter remembered the word the Lord had spoken to him. Before the rooster crows today, you, my beloved Peter, will disown me 3 times. And the words of verse 62, and he went outside. Some translations say, and he wept, 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 and he wept. He wept bitterly. For the very thing that he tried to do, he had failed. He had failed in protecting the master. He had failed in going all the way with him. But this denial was Peter's finest hour. Do you know that? Because the confession which he spoke about in Matthew 16:16, that you are the Son of God, the Son of the living God, you are the Son, the Christ, that very confession in that moment of Jesus' look became a reality to him. He came to the realization that, "Jesus, I thought you needed me. But I need you." Complete surrender in that moment of weakness. And this is where the scripture says, Philippians 4 verse 13, "I can do all things through Christ who gives me strength." When we are at our weakest moments, when we are at our I don't know moments, that is when Christ's strength is perfected in us. And that is why, if you read back the scripture, once you have turned back, Peter, come and strengthen my brothers, because you have learned something in that moment of the strength of the master is not your strength. Once you've discovered that lesson, Peter, turn back and go and tell your brothers. Guys, come to a place, and if you look further into the story in the beginning of Acts, they were in one accord not knowing what to do. They were in a room not knowing what would happen next. Father, you said a helper will come. You said you will send somebody, something that will help us. And they were in this room together. And in their unknowingness, flames of fire, tongues of fire came upon them. Amen. The look of grace. Can you turn with me? This is my conclusion. John 21, verse 15. Father, we are nothing without you. We are nothing without you. John 21. So here we see a reappearance of our friend Simon Peter. Welcome back, Simon. And when they had finished eating, Jesus said to Simon Peter, this is where, if you read the passage before this, they were fishing. We spoke about this word. They were fishing on the seaside, not too far in, and they were throwing the net on the one side. They didn't catch any fish. And Jesus, they didn't know it was Jesus, came to them and said, "Do you have any fish for me?" They said, "No, we do not." And he said, "Do me a favor, throw your net on the other side." And they threw the net on the other side, and they caught a boatload full of fish. And in that moment, go and read the story for yourself. Remember, Peter had failed Jesus at this point. When Peter discovered what had just happened, the word says he cloaked himself and jumped into the water. He jumped out of the boat, similarly to he did before, and he started run swimming to the seashore to meet Jesus. You see, his grace will lead us to his repentance. And when he got there, he made them breakfast, Jesus did. And when they had finished eating, Jesus said to Simon Peter, "Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these?" The cock crow, remember that? Denial number one, do you love me more than these? He said, "Yes, Lord, I know that you love me." And then he said, "Feed my lambs." Go back and tell them. "Yes, Lord, I love you more than these." And then he asked him again, "Simon Peter, son of John, do you love me?" And he answered, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." And Jesus said, "Then take care of my sheep." And the third time, Jesus said to him, "Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these?" And Peter was now hurt, but Jesus was restoring him. Praise God. Peter was now hurt because Jesus asked him a third time, "Do you love me?" But you denied me three times, so I'm asking you, do you love me? And he said, "Lord, you know all things." He came to a realization of Jesus knows more than me. Praise God. "You know all things, and you know that I love you." So Jesus said, "Then go and feed my sheep." Amen. His grace is enough. His strength is made perfect in our weakness. Let us be sons and daughters that are led by the Spirit. Eleanor, are you ready for the table of the Lord? I'm going to ask you guys just to stand up when Eleanor is ready. Thank you, Father, for your word. Thank you for your grace that's upon our lives. Father, we thank you for the table of the Lord. We thank you that it reminds us that you know all things and that you have done all things. Everything we need, Father, is in you. We receive now, Father, the power of your blood. We thank you for the broken body that you've given us so that the veil may be torn, that we can step in boldly into the throne room, that we can boldly come to your feet and partake of that which you've given us, Father. We thank you that you are stronger than we are. We thank you, Father, that you've grace enough to keep loving us. And we pray right now, Father, that you will increase and that we will decrease in the name of Jesus. We bless the table now. We bless the table. Thank you for your blood, Jesus. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. Amen. strength is perfect when our strength is weak. You'll carry us when we can't carry on. Raised in his power, the weak become strong. His strength is perfect. His strength is perfect. His strength is perfect when our strength is gone. He'll carry us when we can't carry on. Raised in his power, the weak become strong. His strength is perfect. His strength is perfect. Yes, his strength is perfect when our strength is gone. He'll carry us when we can't carry on. Raised in his power, the weak become strong. His strength is perfect. His strength is perfect. Raised in his power, the weak become strong. His strength is perfect. His strength is perfect. His strength is perfect when our strength is gone. You carry us. You carry us when we can't carry on. Raised in his power, the weak become strong. His strength is perfect.
Let's sing one more time together. His strength is perfect.
His strength is perfect, and our strength is.
You'll carry us.
He'll carry us when we can't carry on. Raised in his power, the weak become strong. His strength is perfect. His strength is perfect.
Raised in his power.
Raised in his power, the weak become strong. Strength is perfect. His strength is perfect. Yes, his strength is perfect. His strength is perfect.
Father, we give you all the glory, all the honor, that when we are weak, you are strong. That when we don't know what to do, that's exactly where you want us. Holy Spirit, we pray right now that you will come and lead us and guide us once more. Father, we repent right now if our flesh has become too much. And we say right now, Holy Spirit, come and take over once more. Take control. Lead us on. You show us the way. You lead us on. We thank you for the power of the confession. We thank you for the power of the confession that you are the Son of the living God. That there is no one beside you, no one above you. We don't want anything else but you, Jesus. I pray right now as we partake of this table that our love for you will increase, that there will be a deeper intimacy with you, Father. That there will be a growing passion within our hearts to see the kingdom come here on earth as it is in heaven, in Jesus' name. Be glorified. I pray that you'll bless your people as they go now. We plead the blood of the Lamb over them. We thank you for the blood, and we pray the blood over your people right now, over your church. The gates of hell will not prevail against your church in Jesus' name. We thank you for what you're doing. And thank you for what you are still about to do. In Jesus' name, amen.